Hello students, now we will be discussing about the various identification and assessment of specific needs of deprived and marginalized learners. So definitely the first point will be admission form. The second point will be parent-teacher interaction. The third point will be psychological assessment reports, and the fourth one and the last one will be specific assessment report for the person with disability as per the requirement means. So we have to assess the person with disability with the specific type of disability. Now coming to the admission form. So from the admission form we will get to know about the following about a learner. First of all, we will be knowing about the caste of that particular type of a person with disability. The second one will be the religion. The third one will be the gender. The fourth one will be the socioeconomic status. And the fifth one, the last one, will be the parental educational background. Now, coming to the parent-teacher interaction. So parent-teacher interaction can help in revealing various characteristics of the learner. In the interaction, both the parent and the teacher can exchange their observations, various observations, in order to know more about the learner's various types of characteristics like his or her interest, his or her attitude, his or her aptitude, and various issues or problems can be discussed. Such interactions can more little can help the parents as well as the teachers to work together as a team or as a group to help the learner in overcoming his or her issues or problems. Coming to the psychological assessment report. From the school record, it may be known as to how many marginalized learners are there in the school. So there are various types of marginalized learners in different classes. However, they have nearly the same needs and may be addressed accordingly. So first one in this respect is having schools that look into the requirements of the child, changing attitude of teachers and teachers, the curriculum, flexible curriculum and evaluation techniques, modification of instructional technique and mode of communication, physical and psychological barrier-free environment, and creating an inclusive ambience, and regular training of teachers and staff is required. Coming to the meeting the various needs of deprived and marginalized learners in school. So, creation of schools with proper educational facilities is a must. Trained and qualified teachers and staff is also very much important in the educational system. Then, according to that, we have to prepare various learning materials, aids and support which is required by the particular type of a child. The active role of government is very much important to deal with various type of provident of attractive funding and support along with local involvement. So association groups are very much important. According to this, Mothers Teachers Association and Parents Teacher Association, which is the short form of MTA and PTA, are necessary for persuading the parents to send their children to school. Such associations and regular involvement of parents in educational committees are also needed for empowerment of the different stakeholders for student welfare and a better education. Coming to the curriculum, so as we can say, rigid curriculum acts as one of the greatest obstacles in the development of inclusive system of education. Curriculum in many cases is extensive and demanding or centrally designed or rigid, due to which it gives less scope and flexibility for the teachers to experiment and try out any new system. Then coming to the meetings, the needs of deprived and marginalized learners in the school. For developing a desire to go to school, learning in the school must be joyful, meaningful, and interesting in underdeveloped and remote areas. Culture-friendly and child-friendly materials like the false stories, tribal dance and festivals, stories of successful local leaders may be the core curriculum to make learning enjoyable and help to create interest. There is a greater need to provide in capacity building programs to upgrade the professional skills of various teachers. This can be done by providing various motivational and leadership training programs to the teachers time to time. Vocational training programs should be mandatory, or it should be compulsory for the teachers who are serving in various areas, including the tribal areas. As far as practicable, the teachers should be trained in local tribal language or dialect to amplify intensive interaction with the local students or the tribal students, we can say. Now coming to the school-based intervention objectives. So definitely there should be school-based intervention objectives should be present. So first of all, we have to discuss about the initial identification of the beneficiaries. So the beneficiaries we have to identify in our settings so that they can be most identifiable, enjoyable, and they can create their own learning in many manners. Then capacity building of teachers. So the capacity building of the teachers is a very important point, and it should be done in a very systematic and proper manner so that they can enhance their knowledge in a more wider perspective. Coming to the monitoring of learners' performance in school. This improves the performance and preventing the various dropout ratios. So in this respect, first point is, first of all, the weak learners are to be identified and action to be taken at the earliest possible moment. For this, monitoring of attendance, performance, and involvement of students' school activities should be done. Good career guidance and career counseling, as well as making curriculum more flexible and diverse, will be helpful for the at-risk learners, or which are more probable for the dropout. The learners may be encouraged to stay at school and be in touch with education if additional learning supports at the end of the secondary school are arranged. The various guidance and counseling services are very much important. So first of all, school-based intervention for deprived and marginalized learners. So school-based prevention and intervention measures, both directly or indirectly, should aim at reducing early school leaving. School-based intervention would have the following objectives. The first objective should be initial identification of beneficiaries. As we have already discussed, the second point should be capacity building of the teachers. And the third point is monitoring of learners' performance in the respective school. So this will improve the performance and prevention of the dropout. So the first point again is that the weak learners should be identified and action to be taken at the earliest possible moment. For this, monitoring of attendance, performance, and involvement of students' school activities should be done. Good career guidance and career counseling, as well as making curriculum more flexible and diverse, will be helpful for the at-risk learners. The learners may be encouraged to stay at school and be in touch with education if additional learning supports at the end of the secondary school are arranged. So that's all in this particular video. Thank you.